more or less to believe me. But the idea is that if you put periodic oscillating weights, alpha plus and minus, then in the continuum limits, so you will get some slightly oscillating solutions with the period, but in the continuum limits, you can show that you reach an effective surface tension, so an effective total variation, which is given by an anisotropy phi. So maybe So the idea here is that you will approximate integral of phi of grad u if you want here in the limit. And here, phi nu has an explicit solution. It's given by minimization problem where you minimize on a periodicity cell, so which I call y, your total variation with your coefficients alpha, under the constraint that u minus nu dot ij is periodic. So nu appears only in the constraint here. But this depends on u, but only through this periodicity constraint. So it means that essentially u must be a perturbation of the affine function nu dot x, and it's a periodic perturbation. And among all periodic perturbations, you minimize your periodic total variation, if you want. So this gives the effective surface tension. So periodicity cell, but in practice, I will use very small periodicity cell because otherwise I will make big periodic artifacts on my images. So it's not very desirable. But of course, you could imagine to do larger things. Okay, so wait. So in that particular case, so I consider only the simplest problem here, of course. The idea would be to solve a loss, so L of alpha, alpha are the coefficients, and this loss is given by the sum of phi of nu I minus one square. So nu I is a set of direction you choose in advance on the circle, if you want, and for each unit vector in this set of direction, you want phi to be as close as one as possible so that you mimic the isotropic total variation for which phi of nu is one. So to solve that, you have to estimate the gradient of phi of nu I with respect to the coefficient alpha. So this case is simple because in that case, the minimal energy is solved by a very simple saddle point problem. So which I can write in this form. So D depends on alpha, if you want. It acts on U and W. W here is in a fixed convex set, and U is a fixed convex set, but which depends on U. So the dependence of U is that. If I just consider this problem, it's a bit difficult. There is a problem because, for instance, U can be non-unique, also W could be non-unique. The problem is highly non-smooth. But so what we do is regularize slightly this problem by some quadratic penalization. So here I have this special form of the quadratic penalization because this is a function which should be periodic. So, and if you take epsilon very, very small, you can show that you don't perturb this too much. In that case, you have a unique solution for each D. And in that case, the analysis is very simple. So because of the regularization, of course, you can show easily that W of D is a continuous function of D. And also that this function phi nu is in fact a C11, so C11, that means with Lipschitz gradient of D. And so locally Lipschitz, in fact, it's locally C11. But so this is quite obvious because if you consider first the inner minimization problem here, of course, here it's a Lejeune functional, it's a convex conjugate. So you see that it's convex with 1/ε Lipschitz gradient as a function of du. So it's a convex with C/ε Lipschitz gradient with respect to d in a neighborhood of d, if C is a constant which is larger than U. than the norm of U, because U is continuous. So if you have such a constant, then in the neighborhood of D, then U will be also below C, and you can see that this is theoretically fits. So in particular, the infimum here has a notion which is bounded from above. And reasoning similarly with taking first the inf and then the sup, then you get a bound from below. So now you know that your function is differentiable. And your function being differentiable, then you can just compute the differential by very simple analysis. So this at this point is just an exercise. You estimate, for instance, from above this quantity for a small variation L. And in fact, you find, which is of course greatly expected, and maybe some of you were used to that, would have known that from the beginning, that the gradient is precisely given by UV, by this expression, sorry. Where am I? Okay. So the gradient is W tensor U. So in that case, of course, it's easy. You just need to solve this saddle point problem. You evaluate UW, you implement your gradient descent, and you can optimize your criterion. And this works, this is easy and works very well. So to illustrate this with an example. So of course, an interesting extension, which should be still relatively easy, is to consider the problem with the smoothing only with respect to U or W, because you expect to be to find a sub and super gradients in this way, of course. But this is something not so interesting, so I did not investigate it too much. I wanted to try just. So as an application, if you take a 2x2 periodicity cell, you can optimize and you find that the best you can do is this. And actually, this is the case, it is a particular case for which I know the explicit solution, and you can find explicitly the coefficients by hand in that case. So this plot is essentially it's the level set of the function phi of nu, if you want, that you get by this optimization. Okay. If you take a 4x4 periodicity cell, you can improve a bit your anisotropy. You still see that it's not perfect. If you take 8x8, then it's almost perfect. But of course, here you start to have problems that you will see that the solutions here are quite oscillating, and you start to see the oscillating patterns. So this is the effective surface tension, but it's effective at a scale only at a scale larger than 8. So okay. So to illustrate a bit, but on really toy examples. If you take this silhouette of a horse, which is in the scikit toolbox in Python, and just solve the RF problem with these different total variations defined by the coefficients. So if you use L1 TV, of course, you get a very boxy result. If you use this 2x2 approximation, oscillating approximation, so which gives this anisotropy, you get a much less blocky result, but of course you see that vertical, horizontal, and slanted 45 degrees slanted direction as are favored. And if you take the 4x4, 8x8 periodicity cell, you start to see a result which looks much more like an isotropic total variation minimization with, let's say, constant curvature region, so region which looks like arcs of circles. But of course, if you start to look closely, so here you see, of course, you have squares for the L1 TV. Here you see the strong anisotropy. Here it's more isotropic, but you start to see, for instance, here oscillating patterns in your edges. So of course maybe 4x4 is a good compromise, because you don't see too much the oscillations, and still it's quite isotropic. Okay. I just for fun, I did some kind of denoising with this, but of course, total version is not so good for denoising. And of course, there is absolutely no way to see any difference between all these at a large scale. Actually, I could have, I did not cheat. I could have cheated a bit. And by cheating a bit, it's easy to make situations where L1 behaves very differently because it weights with a very different weight, a 45 degree line than vertical or horizontal lines. But if you take a generic image, you don't see any difference. If you zoom a lot, you start to see some differences. And I must say that this one is a bit nicer than this one, but it's hard to tell. And the 2x2 is not very nice because here you see the oscillation due to the fact it favors vertical and 45 degree line. But this is really, I mean, this is a bit for fun. Okay, so now, let me consider the problem of more general losses, which is a bit more complicated. So, So here, if the energy you want to solve, which depends on D, instead of depending, so L, small l here will always be a smooth function, for instance, a quadratic function, but you could take different functions. So instead of being small l of the energy of D, if it depends on U and possibly W, the primal and dual variables, then you cannot do something as simple. So a typical example that which we have studied in a paper which we wrote last year with Thomas is to optimize with respect to an operator D for you solving either this problem or I should have written also the Dirichlet problem because we studied more the Dirichlet problem actually than this RF problem. And here D, we are choosing D in a class of operators which realize a consistent discretization of the total variation, consistent meaning that in the limit where the size of the pixel vanish, then it approximates the isotropic total variation. So, and the idea here was to measure the discrepancy between U and D and the true solution for problems for which the true solution is available. Okay, so in that case, the situation is a bit more complicated. And what we did, rather than studying the problem in the continuum setting and try to find standard formulas for the adjoint problem and etc., we started from the optimization. And the idea is we are optimizing a bilinear saddle point problem. So of the form min x sub y of g of x plus kx y minus f star of y, which is a generic form. Maybe I should have written it on the slide, which is a generic form here, of course, for f, okay, of kx plus g of x. Okay. So, and here we were considering this problem with, of course, the restrictive assumption again that G and F star are strongly convex, so that there's a unique saddle point, which here is a bit more important than in the previous setting because we will want to derivate x and y with respect to k, and it's a bit complicated when you have non-uniqueness, but it would be interesting to extend the work by removing some of these assumptions. So the idea now is how do you differentiate with respect to k? Okay, so very recently, there have been quite a lot of work doing this kind of thing with a method which is no. It's not the classical method, but now it's the classical method. And what most people do is they implement a first order algorithm to approximate U of K by some iterate UN. And then you unroll the iteration as if it were like a very large sort of neural network. And you use automatic differentiation and backpropagation to estimate the gradient with respect to your coefficients of the network here of the last iterate. So that's interesting because it's relatively easy to implement now in packages like PyTorch or whatever, because it's already implemented more or less in the programming language. But of course, you see that first there is an issue which is never really discussed, which I don't know, that there is a strange dependence on U0 here when you do that, which actually I don't know how people do deal with. But the difficulty we encountered when you wanted to solve our problems with this technique is that it's difficult when your problem is start to be very large or start to be very slowly converging. So if you need many iterations, then you will have to use many iterations to use a lot of memory. And unless you have a huge computer, your automatic differentiation and backpropagation breaks down. So we had to revert to a more classical method, which is to do some sensitivity analysis. And I will now explain during the end of the talk how we do that. And more interesting, what the results are. Because the sensitivity analysis is very classical. And in the first step, we assume that F and G are smooth. Of course, that's bad. And I will of course, return on this issue in the end, later on. So first, to derive the derivative with the sensitivity analysis, then we assume that F and G are smooth. So in that case, it's easy. You just have K, your operator, you have a perturbation of K, which I called L. So you consider the point K plus TL, and you have a solution, a saddle point XTYT, and you write the stationary condition, and then you can just derivate the stationary condition. And in fact, you can even justify very easily your derivation because of the strong convexity of G and F star, which yield that the solution Y and X are Lipschitz and even differentiable. So you write this, you can derivate formally or not formally, but whatever you do, you will end up with that. Assuming, of course, that G is C2 and F star is C2. So you get a system for Xi and Eta, which are the derivative of X and Y. And this system, of course, is easy to invert. And of course, you can invert it because of your assumption that D2G and D2F star are positive operators. So this is a strongly monotone operator, so it has an inverse. So you can write psi eta as the inverse of this operator applied to minus L star Y0 L X0. So this is really straightforward calculation. And then you express the gradient of your loss in the direction L, simply as the gradient of the small smooth function L at the point x0, y0, which is the optimal point, times the derivative of xy, which is xi eta. This gives this easy formula here, grad L of k dot L equals to this as a linear function, of course, of L. And now, of course, when you see that, it's very standard, but it's very easy. When you see that this formula, you see that naturally appears some adjoint state here. So I define the adjoint state minus x, y transpose as this thing here, so that the gradient is expressed in this form. And now I can remove L, and the gradient depends only on the adjoint state and the solution. So this there's nothing new here, really. It's just deriving some equilibrium equations, some minimality problem. Okay, so of course, what is nice with the adjoint state, as usual, is that the adjoint state does not depend on the direction where you are differentiating. It depends only on the sensitivity, so the derivative of your loss function. So it's written explicitly like that. It solves explicitly this problem, and this problem is exactly the equilibrium equation condition for a linearized or quadratic saddle point problem, which is a sort of tangent saddle point problem to your initial problem, with the additional term here due to the loss. Okay, up to now, nothing really new, but the form is nice. So now if you want to solve that, what can you do? Of course, you can solve that with some primal dual saddle point iteration. And if you do that, you will have iteration of this form. So here you have a sort of explicit descent on a linearized term, on the linear term. And here you have some kind of prox of the quadratic term. Okay, so you have to compute the prox of the quadratic term, which could be an issue. But of course, there is an obvious remark here, which is nice, which is that this prox is not an arbitrary thing. It's essentially, it's exactly the gradient of the prox of tau g. At least if you evaluate it at the prox itself. Yeah. Okay, so, but the solution here is also a prox of something, of course, because the subgradient of G is not empty. So this formula makes sense here. Okay, and the next remark, which is interesting, is that here normally you would have to solve for X and then for Y, also for X and Y, and then to solve for large X. But what you can do, or try to do, is run in parallel the algorithm for computing x0, y0, and xy. So this leads to, so this is the basic idea of what we call the piggyback differentiation algorithm. So this was introduced by Grewanc and Four, and the idea is really, it's exactly this setting, because essentially you want to solve, to evaluate the derivative of a fixed point, and the fixed point is essentially a contractive fixed point, which is more or less our case because we have a strongly convex objectives with respect to some parameters. So, but most of the studies in Grewanc and Four and subsequent papers are considering smooth cases, and we'll see that sort of part of the smoothness can be a bit relieved. So. For this particular setting, we can use the primal dual algorithm, which we had proposed in 2011. You can use other algorithms actually, and you will get similar results. But it was simpler to write it in this form. So here, the primal dual iteration of this algorithm has this form. So I write only the primal here. So the idea is that xk plus one is the prox of tau j as some iterate, and large xk plus one is the gradient of the prox of tau j at the same point applied to some vector. So this makes the piggyback method very, very easy and nice to implement in that case, because what you simply do is implement the primal dual method and compute a sort of automatic differentiation of derivative at the same time. So you start with your point x0, y0, and large x0, large y0, so you can take zero, you can take iterates from some previous iteration also, which can improve a bit the quality of your gradients. And then for each k, so you compute a sort of linear descent for the bilinear term here, and including the gradient part here. And then you compute the prox of tau j of this term, and using automatic differentiation, you compute the gradient of the prox of tau j at the same point applied to this term. And here you do some sort of over relaxation step, which in particular, since we're in the strongly convex case, can improve slightly the convergence rate. I mean, it improves. You can take theta equals one, and choosing theta a bit smaller can improve slightly the convergence rate here. you compute your iterates in the same way for the dual variables. So first the linear term, and then the progs and the gradient of the progs using automatic differentiation. This is a very, very simple method, and it's very simple to implement, in particular in PyTorch. So I have to hopefully we have a few theoretical results, otherwise it will be quite empty. So there's one theoretical result which I find interesting, but it's not fully satisfactory, is that the method makes sense without really assuming any regularity of G and F star, as we had said. For deriving the equation, I assume that G and F star were C2. But in fact, if they are just strongly convex, without any further assumption, and if you have a fixed point of the algorithm where the algorithm makes sense, so which means where this gradient exists, and this gradient exists. So why do I say that? Because these prox operators are Lipschitz operators, so they have gradients almost everywhere. But of course, you have to make sure that the gradient precisely exists at the point x minus tau k star y and x plus sigma kx, which is, sorry, there is a mistake. No, this is ku. There is a typo somewhere here. Yeah, this is why. This is why. Yeah. So if you have a fixed point of the algorithm for which this exists, then you can show that your loss is differentiable and the loss has the expression you expect, y tensor x plus y tensor x. I mean, small y tensor large x plus large y tensor small x. Of course, this assumption still imply, but this up to now we do not know how to remove that G star and F are convex with Lipschitz gradient. Okay, for the convergence we need slightly more because I will explain why. So we need that G F star strongly convex, but we need also that G star and F are a bit more than C11, which is what would imply strongly convex. So we need that the second derivative is locally older. So locally C2 alpha, if you want, for some alpha. Then in that case, if you choose well your time steps, your steps for the algorithms, then the iterates converge linearly to a fixed point. And at the fixed point, of course, you have the previous theorem. So this is interesting because you don't really need, for instance, G to be C2, or of course, in the applications we are using, it is F which is not smooth and G is smooth. So, okay, the result is not perfect. But still, it's a case of differentiation in situations which are not necessarily smooth. So before showing a few examples and finishing, let me just mention a few points of the proofs. I mean, I will not describe anything on the proof, but why essentially does it work? Because I gave essentially the proof that it should work if G and F are smooth, F star are smooth. So if they are not smooth, of course, first, what you can do a lot is rely on Morrow's identity. So Morrow's identity is nice because it relates the gradient of the progs of tau G with the gradient of the progs of 1 over 2 G star. So if in particular, if you know when one gradient is defined that the other is defined, etc. Also, there's also a formula I mentioned already that the gradient of the progs of tau G is given by this formula. But you see in this formula that if G, for instance, is for instance an L1 norm, then this can be singular, but this can be singular essentially with infinite eigenvalues, and then you take the inverse. So it means that even at points where this is singular, this in fact can exist. And in fact, in general, that's what will happen, because when this is zero, then in general, this will be zero. So if you manipulate carefully your proxies and the points where your gradients are defined or not defined, you can show the previous results without too much regularity on the functions. Okay, next point. For the convergence of the algorithm, we use a Somorrow-Yosidai regularization, which shows in particular that if G star is C2 alpha, which is what we had to assume, then this is a small technical point. You can show that if G star is C2 alpha plus some condition, then also the Morrow-Yosidai regularization will be C2 alpha. So this quantity will be order continuous, which means that this gradient is order continuous. So it gives you that your proxy is C1 alpha. So again, thanks to this analysis, you can show the convergence. How do you do that? What happens is that then, thanks to this assumption, at each iterate, you make an error between the value where you evaluate grad L or grad prox to G with respect to the value where you would like to evaluate it, which is the optimal limit value. But this value is bounded and is controlled thanks to the linear convergence of the point xk, yk to the solution. And thanks to this linear convergence, you can get linear convergence essentially and summability of the errors. So you can write all this as a sort of primal dual iteration with summable errors. And you can do some analysis. For instance, there is one analysis with weights, which is done in a recent paper with Yuran Rash, and end up with linear convergence for also the adjoint states. Okay. Okay, so I will finish. Maybe some remarks. Yeah. Of course, what would be nice would be to drop a bit further the regularity assumptions. But even for the first theorem, even if the proxy is differentiable almost everywhere, I don't know that it's not clear that it will be differentiable precisely at some fixed point. So I don't know if you can maybe you can do a bit better by having only sided derivatives and still show something. So that would be interesting. One remark is that it's very easy to see that the same adjoint states can be used to derivate with, if you have parameters in the function f of g or g. For instance, if you have f star of y theta and you want to derivate with respect to theta, then it is exactly the same adjoint you compute. So the adjoint state can be used to solve problems with many different expressions. But in that case, it's just interesting in the sense that I cannot prove anything if I don't assume that my f star is very smooth. So, but computationally the same. So one example, as I mentioned before, we wanted to optimize discretization of the total variation in order to solve Rudin or Shor-Fatemi or in painting problems. So in painting means completing lines essentially in 2D. And maybe we will implement also 3D problems because it's a bit more interesting. So you want to set up a boundary condition and you want to find back this line. And if you do forward differences, you get this Ravier-Thoma, okay, or different. So Konda works very well, Konda or Intermuller, if you want. And then this is some different approach we introduce with a certain number of filters. So don't really worry about the parameters here. The point is that with varying parameters and learning, we can really get results which are as good as this. And in fact, if you measure in terms of error and RMSC, then it's strictly better. Actually, I can show these curves also, which are maybe, I don't know if they are easy to interpret. This is sort of PSNR as a function of the angle. So the idea is that this is a discontinuity at a certain angle. And we rotate the angle and we try all different angles and we try to learn. Of course, you don't want to learn for one angle. You want to learn simultaneously for all possible directions. Otherwise, you will get a total variation which works very well for this angle, but doesn't work for other directions. So if you look just at forward differences of this Ravier-Thoma, then you see that the PSNR is good only in a certain number of directions, which is essentially our vertical and horizontal direction, and sometimes also some 45 degrees directions. and the conda discretization is a bit better. But if you learn with different settings, then you can get an improved PSNR in most directions. This is, for instance, the orange curve, where in almost all directions, I could have shown a picture, but it's essentially straight lines. You can get almost perfect reconstruction of straight lines, giving only the boundary conditions. Okay, so I think I don't have much more to say. Yeah, maybe some perspectives. So we've been trying to use that for some learning or classification problem by solving some lasso and try to learn the best lasso to solve some classification problem, but it's too simple. So it works very well, meaning the piggyback algorithm and the gradient and the optimization works perfectly, but the problem is too simple and we get a lot of overfitting because we on the learning set and of course it's very bad on the test set. So we need to find a bit more complex ideas to apply that to learning. What would be interesting theoretically to understand, because actually what I did not say here is that when we do this computation, we don't put any smoothing. So there is not epsilon u square, epsilon w square, and it should not be working. The piggyback should not even converge. It's not clear what happens. But still, we compute very good gradients and the optimization works very well. So if the gradients are good and it works, it means that something happens. So it's computing something. And I don't know what it's computing. So it's computing some gradient. Also, what we should do is compare with backpropagation, but we could not really do that for the inpainting experiments because for the inpainting experiment, the convergence is very slow. We don't put any regularization because it rinses the result. So the convergence is very slow. And it exceeds the capacity of all the computers we could try for backpropagation. So we should try with simpler problem to compare the solutions given by this kind of approach and backpropagation. Okay, so that's, I think, all I wanted to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the very nice talk, the very interesting results. So are there any questions?
Should I see the questions or do you have to?
They will just unmute the microphones, I guess, or ask the questions first in the chat. But then I have a first question. So there are some recent developments on let's say min-max problems with some coupling function, which is not necessarily bilinear, and regularizers, let's say, convex and concave, where the algorithm provided there rely on your primer dual method. Yeah? They don't have this AXY or KXY, they just try to mimic in the algorithm yeah, this bilinear term. For instance, there is an IBAT paper, which is this idea. So what about extending your approach to the general case of a general coupling function?
Yeah, I think if you put an enough smoothness, I don't think it should be too complicated. But the problem then, the problem is to have some theoretical result which work in practical settings where you don't have so much smoothness and whatever. So in smooth case, I think you can do some sensitivity analysis and probably get similar results. If you have a convex concave, let's say, non-linear term, but smooth enough. I don't expect, actually I would be interested also to understand what happens for non-linear, but this is a bit harder, I think. For non-linear optimization with many, maybe Bregman prox functions or
yes,
that could be interesting.
But as I said, so this type of extensions to min-max problems with non-bilinear coupling functions, so there is a lot of motivation for such problems, and like the let's say the Chambolle-Poque algorithm, it was extended to this setting. And I guess that the techniques represented today could be also extended, but of course, for under smoothness assumptions. So
I guess. For instance, well, something which could be interesting is to understand if you can derivate easily for approximation of assignment or optimal transport problems solved by some nonlinear technique in a similar way. I think it should work.
Okay, and then another question. Probably this also explains the what you mentioned at the end. So the primary dual method, the classical one, it was shown to work also for weakly convex functions. Yeah. So just because of the proximal terms, but just by choosing this step size. I mean, okay. Yes. And then so this is a question. Yes. So you said that you in your implementation, the numerics, you didn't use this epsilon technique, like where you added the strongly convex term. Yeah. But what about writing the function, the convex function as a weakly convex plus this quadratic term? And so to have something like this in the back, let's say. Yeah?
So you mean to add the strong convexity as an artificial smoothing and then try to, for instance, remove it?
Yes.
Oh yes, this is something I've been trying a bit to explore, but I'm not sure I understand really well what the limit should be. But I think it's the right path to follow, because to understand the difference of between the gradient you're computing in this way and some kind of subgradient or some kind of so
I mean writing convexity as weakly convexity plus the quadratic term you need here. And then, so writing the convex function as a weakly convex, yeah, and then adding the quadratic term you would need to go for the derivative. Yeah, so just to make a step back from convexity, but then to get the term you need. I mean, just because the primal dual algorithm works also for weakly convex functions.
Yeah. That's true. Sure. Okay. Maybe one thing which could be easy, I started to look a bit at that. One thing which could be easier is to have one function which is strongly convex and to smooth the other, as you're saying, and then try to understand what error you're making when you do that. And I think this should lead somewhere.
Okay. Yes. But, are there other questions?
I don't see any questions. So.
No more questions.
And I could not find how to record it either, because I see that's throwing me high.
But at least we will put the slides and we will post them on the website, and then it's not clear what happened with the recording function. So then. Thank you again for the very interesting talk. So this is a very cool topic, and as you noticed, with a lot of potential. So Mark, is there something you'd like to add?
Well, thank you, Antonin. It was very interesting. Actually, you mentioned the nonlinear type of problem, but these are much more difficult from my experience.
Yes. Yes.
Very difficult. In fact, you are losing also some convexity, concavity when you put a nonlinear operator. So anyways, that's a completely different piece of cake. But apparently in the applications that Antonin mentioned, I don't think that he needs to consider a nonlinear operator. So I guess it's already not completely trivial this way. So I mean, you have to assume, for example, the strong convexity assumption on both the pair of GF star or vice versa. And so that's life.
It's not a very non-smooth setting.
So anyway.
Yeah, you have some non-smoothness, but really. Very specific type.
Is there a chance to, let's say, to take a different type of differentiability, to look at some weaker I mean, would
yeah, I think that's yeah, I think that's the idea, some kind of limit differentiability, yes, and of the many notions.
Yeah, but then it becomes a bit more baroque, I think. I mean,
yes.
I mean, the question is, what can you really compute with this?
It's
not always clear.
Mm.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, but actually, I was surprised that the gradients are quite stable without strong convexity, and it doesn't seem to make sense actually, because the way we solve is not clear at all that it's converging to something, and it seems to. Mm-hmm. So it's strange.
Hmm. Yeah, we notice again that the power of convexity and the strong convexity and interplay with the differentiability when going to dual objects and indeed it's not so easy yet to weaken these things and then. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
Very nice experience. Very nice talk. Yeah, it's a great experience.
Thanks.
So wish you all the best. Have a nice week and see you next month. For another
stuff. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.